So, I see some faces, some repeat faces today, so that's really exciting, and I really appreciate everybody being here today. My name is Joan Halpolis. I'm the director of Justice Movement here at Fox Christie, and we have a fabulous, incredible, dedicated Justice Council here at Fox Christie. Could the Justice Council folks please wave, say hi to folks? Yeah, so this Justice Speaker Series was the brainchild, and through prayer and discernment, the Justice Council knew that we needed to be moving in a certain direction together as a community to really understand the most pressing needs of our society, since that is in our purpose statement. Our mission statement, our purpose statement says that we address the most pressing needs, and how do we do that if we don't understand them? We also know that our Justice Council purpose statement says that we also are tasked with creating opportunities for social action. And so this is our fourth of our six-part series for this fiscal year. And what we're doing is we're looking at issues and also hopefully helping people to connect to what action you can take after listening to the issues at hand. And for some people, it will look different than for other people, but it seems like we're kind of moving in the right direction with that. So on these tables, there are places for you to sign in to let us know you're here. Even if you signed in last month, it would be nice to sign in again today so that we can keep track of who's repeat customers. And then there are a couple of different opportunities to sign up for. We're thinking that we may be beginning a housing team here at Fox Christie to be in response to this ongoing conversation and the need. And so if that's interesting to you, please sign that paper too. And then also the day on the Hill for the Minnesota Housing Coalition is in March, and so there's also a sign-up sheet for that. So if you have a mind that you'd like to go to that lobby day, sign up for it, because we can all kind of do it together, and it will be really great. So I'd like to introduce Ann Mabby. I don't even know how long ago I met you, Ann. A while ago. Ann is the executive director for the Minnesota Housing Partnership, and we actually at Fox Christie kind of got connected with Ann in a way, as we were really intentional for several years in a row with the effort that Beacon Interfaith Housing Collaborative was doing. We did a lot of those postcards. We showed up for lobby days. You all might remember becoming Beacon citizens in support of what the Homeless Coalition was proposing each year. I'm really thrilled that Ann is with us today to talk to us about affordable housing. And I can't wait for you to dig in. I'll let her tell you a little bit more about herself as she tells us more about Minnesota Housing Partnership. So, thank you.
So again, my name is Ann Mabby, and lots of folks have different kinds of expertise in the world, and the expertise on housing that I'm going to bring today is the work that I've done over several years in really focusing on the policies and the financing that it takes to create affordable housing. But there's lots of different kinds of expertise, right, in the room, and how many of you all have lived in housing? but that's not true of every room. But you all have expertise in your life experience and what that path has been for you, and everyone brings a different point. Today, we're going to focus a little bit on sort of the facts and the figures of affordable housing and what it takes to create that. And I'll just do a quick introduction. I'm coming to you today here as the executive director of Minnesota Housing Partnership, and I'll talk just a little bit about MHP and what we do. Prior to that, I led development for a nonprofit, Beacon Interfaith Housing Collaborative. We had some wonderful projects, a signature project in Edina you might have heard about, 66 West Apartments for homeless youth, one of the first affordable housing developments Edina has ever done. And since then, the organizing and the community that really came out to support that has really transformed the policies and the approach in Edina to affordable housing. So it's possible to sort of see that transformation of communities really understanding the kind of impact they can have and the asset that housing can bring. And prior to that, I've worked a lot in the area of supportive housing, so really tying together services with housing through the national nonprofit Appropriation for Supportive Housing, and I've worked in Congress on the Subcommittee on Housing, so I've been involved in lots of different ways. So we have this. So today I'll just do a quick overview, and also let me just say, please interrupt me as we go, and I'm hoping that this will be a conversation. I'm going to outline a little bit of what I'll be covering today, but I'm guessing that you'll have a lot of questions that aren't going to be in this, so just feel free to interrupt. So the Minnesota Housing Partnership, I've been there just over a year. It was founded almost 27 years ago and really brings together a lot of the housing people who are interested in stakeholders who are interested in housing with a particular focus on producing and preserving affordable housing. And we are rooted in Minnesota and work in a lot of communities throughout Minnesota, but we actually also work nationwide. So the name is a little bit of a misnomer because we work in rural communities and native communities. We get a lot of HUD and USDA grants to work around the country and really strengthening communities, knowing that housing is a core part of a strong community. And so that's what we do. So we work in those three areas. As I mentioned, the working directly with communities is typically with smaller rural communities and native communities. Where we'll go in, they might have 6,000 folks in their town, and they don't have a lot of depth in housing expertise, and so we come in to sort of help them do that. And then we also produce a lot of research. And part of the handouts and what you see is a piece of it, but our website gets almost 60,000 hits a year. And if you want to know about housing in Minnesota, start with our website, and you can find out all kinds of information. In early March, we're going to come out with our biannual, is that every 2 years? Report called State of the State of Housing in Minnesota. And that really provides sort of this big overview about the challenges and the opportunities that we're facing. And then the other years, every other year, we then produce these legislative profiles that you can get on our website. So if you want to engage and feel like you need the tools to engage with your elected officials, and we have samples of them here. I was plucking out some of the legislative districts around here, 49B, 49A. You can actually go to our website and get the facts and figures of your own backyard to take and use. Although I would say, you don't have to be an expert to talk about it. Your expertise is what you know, where your values lead you. The facts and figures are to support that. But you have the expertise to engage with the policymakers to talk about. So, yes, ma'am.
Your day at the Hill, do you give people a background before they go to their legislators?
Absolutely. Yeah, the Homeless Day on the Hill is sponsored by the Minnesota Coalition for the Homeless. And there's a gathering ahead of time to make sure that you feel like you have the facts and figures. Again, you can get some of them for your own community right now. But I just want to be clear, you already have that expertise. What you know and see what's happening in the community, the values that you bring in terms of why housing is important for everybody, you've already got. So some people feel like they need to know all the details, and you do not. But why does housing matter, right? Why does housing matter? And we talk about this as, it's where children learn. We've got a big initiative at the state legislature right now called Homework Starts with Home, right? How do kids do homework without a home? And really trying to link together schools and the work that they're doing together to support the families and keep them stably housed. Now, we know that workers who don't have stable housing, it's a challenge for but just showing up at work, etc. And we're also increasingly engaging employers in understanding that their growth is inhibited if there's not enough housing for workers. Did you guys see the Star Tribune article a couple of days ago? Talking about how the housing, rental housing in Minneapolis at 5,000 units was not keeping up with the growth.
Yes. Yeah.
And so what we're seeing increasingly is this like constraint on business growth because there's not enough housing to support that. And so they need to attract talent and workers and are getting inhibited because there's not enough affordable housing. We know with seniors on limited income that it's absolutely critical that there's stable housing for seniors who are increasingly, as housing costs escalate and fixed incomes do not, that increasingly become the squeeze. And of course that means that health outcomes and other kinds of things are at risk because of people making choices about, do I keep my housing or do I pay for other necessary and needed things? And then, of course, communities prosper, right? This is an asset. And this is one of the things I just want to make sure that we continue to think about. Sometimes when people think about, what's affordable housing, right? I don't know what's in your head when you say affordable housing, what you think about, right? But it's an asset for our community. And we can't function and have folks taking care of our kids, have folks giving coffee to our kids, have folks taking care of our parents. All those folks need housing that's affordable to them. And our communities cannot thrive without all of that. Any comments or thoughts on sort of that basic? Does that make sense? Okay. So what's affordable, right? Typically, we talk about affordable housing as being 30% of income. Now, of course, when you get to the far ends of the income scale, that doesn't make quite as much sense, right? So if I'm making $1 million a year, I'm probably not spending 30% of my income on housing. At the same time, if I'm making $6,000 a year, I don't even have 30% of my income to spend on housing, right? But the general rule of thumb is saying you shouldn't be paying more than 30% of your total income on housing in order to have enough money for transportation, for health, for food, for other kinds of basic costs that you have. So that's the general rule. Again, when you get to the very poorest and the very wealthy, that falls apart a little bit. Yeah?
I noticed the 30% came from 1981. Do you feel like it still holds up at 30%?
So there's a lot, that's a great question. There's a lot of conversation about transportation costs and how they contribute to housing. So some folks think about transportation and housing together shouldn't be 50% of your costs. So there's other kinds of considerations. So I would say, and there are so many households that are cost burdened, which we'll talk about in a minute, that are paying more than 30% of their income for housing. And so I think a lot of this is in flux. It's a benchmark. It's a rule of thumb just to be thinking about in terms of what's to book. Yeah, Joe.
Also, I just noticed your pie says rent 30%, but really if we're talking about healthy housing, if you're a homeowner or a renter, you don't want your monthly cost to be more than 30% or that combined cost, is that correct?
That is true. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. That is true. Yeah, and most of what I'm talking about typically involves rent, the rental market, and that's probably the crux of what we'll be talking about today, although we'll talk a little bit about homeownership and the disparities in homeownership and other kinds of models to access affordability.
And ownership impacts rental. Is
absolutely.
The so
at all. So this is the thing. The whole market is tied together. So we need more housing across every income level. We are just not keeping up with population growth, with business growth. We need more housing across every income scale. But of course, that becomes most dramatic then when you get to the lowest income. So why is housing unaffordable, right? Like, why is this such a conundrum as we're trying to solve for this? And I'm going to go through in the rest of the presentation really these four areas. One is that incomes are just too low. and we're going to talk a little bit about that, that it is, there's just a structural mismatch for what incomes are out there for the typical jobs, for folks that need help on the lower income, and what's available. It's too low. The cost to develop and operate housing and create rents or home ownership for that matter, that are simply outside of what folks can afford. So again, there's a structural economic mismatch that we're going to talk a little bit about. Certain types of government regulation are raising these costs and then therefore reduce the overall supply. We've heard a lot about this in the paper about the Minneapolis 2040 plan, and we'll dig into some of those strategies and other kinds of strategies that can help facilitate and get through, but where government regulation can be a problem. And then, you know, we know what works. Oftentimes I say affordable housing is just a math problem, right? We have really evidence-based strategies that are effective to solve for these affordable housing challenges, and we're not investing in them. And so we know what works, and we are not investing at the level that we need to actually have the impact and solve for that. So we're going to dig into this a little bit. So, and let me just say, some of this data, I'm not positive if it's the exact same data, the trends are the same. So we are just updating some data. This is 2015, you might have 2017 there, but don't get hung up on that. The trends are the same. So what's happening out there? In Hennepin County, and again, we look at renter households, and what's happening is that rents are going up and incomes are going down. And this is already inflation adjusted, right? So what we have is this trend line that is simply unsustainable, right? Where rents keep going up and up and up, and incomes are not. Either they're stagnant or going down. So the ability to actually access and purchase the kind of housing in the past is a challenge, right? Let me ask in this room, you guys remember your first apartment or your first mortgage? How much did you pay? You remember?
$500 a month?
$300 a month.
Anyone else?
$199.50.
$199, he wins, right? I live over in St. Louis Park, and my first apartment was on Hennepin Avenue. I was a neighborhood organizer in Minneapolis, and I paid $260 for a really large one-bedroom apartment right on Hennepin. And my children are in their early 20s, and my daughter was looking for an apartment. And that building had an apartment available, so I called it up, right? Just to... So basically the same income that she's making, right, as a 21-year-old that I was making back then, because the incomes haven't changed that much, that $260 a month apartment is now $960 a month. And not a lot of other stuff has changed in whatever, 20, no, probably 30 years, but who's counting? So, but the point is that this is just a structural mismatch, and it's just to understand, because I think a lot of times people think about, well, you know, people should be pulling themselves up by the bootstraps, doing this, and it's like, well, if you don't have boots, there's no straps to pull, right? And so just to be clear about where some of the challenges are, where they're actually in the market. It's not about people, it's about the market. Any other questions on this? So, related to this, the other key piece is that hard-working folks working full-time at a minimum wage job still can't afford a typical two-bedroom apartment. And so, if you're a single parent, you're working full-time and you're trying to get into the market, again, the folks that are, giving me my coffee in the morning, taking care of my kids, it's really hard to actually afford a typical apartment. And so what's happening, what happens, right? People are working two jobs or three jobs or they're living in housing that's substandard, right? Which often means that then they're changing housing, because when you're living in substandard housing, things happen and you want to get out of it, you move to the next one. So that kind of housing instability, the cost burdens, you end up paying much more than 30% of your income to access that housing. So again, there's this mismatch between what's out there. And so when you think about, as you go through your day, all the people you're interacting with, what is it that they're going through? Do they have to drive an hour to come to take, you know, to the daycare to take care of the kids? Do you want them to be tired driving an hour away because there's no housing in the community, right? Those kinds of things. So I'll note that as an aside, MHP, last August, we did a statewide poll on housing. And one of the most interesting data points is we asked folks, should folks be able to live in the community in which they work? 80% of folks said, yeah. You know, you should be able to afford to live in the community in which you work, 80%. So we feel like there's a public will out there to address this, you know, but again, you know, we've got some structural challenges to that. So the result of all of this is that folks are paying way too much for their housing, right? And that, of course, is impacting people at the lower end of the income scale most. So when you look at folks that are making less than $26,000 a year, almost 94,000 households in the Twin Cities are paying more than half of their income for housing. And what does that mean for the other choices they're making? Right? So, and that's not good for us as a community, right? We want stable families, we want stable communities, the kids that are with our kids in the classroom, we want to make sure that it's in everyone's interest that folks have stability. And again, that cost burden diminishes, understandably, as you go up the income scale, but it doesn't go away. And we'll talk a little bit about this middle income. It's getting squeezed and squeezed and squeezed as well. Any questions on that?
What's AMI?
Oh, thank you. Sorry about that. We talk a lot about area median income. So in the Twin Cities, our area median income these days, I think the most recent one is around $94,000, right? So extraordinarily high.
What did you say?
What?
And I think one way to think of the area median income is half of all incomes are above that line, and half of all incomes are below.
What was the figure?
Household income.
So what was the number?
About $94,000. It varies year to year, but the most recent one has gone up, right? So what's that?
For Hennepin
County? No, for the Twin Cities. For the Twin Cities, for the 7-county area, the median income is $94,000. So then we talk about 50% of the area median income would be half of that, $45,000, right? That's a good, a good job, working, doing good work somewhere. But that's 50% of the area median income. And when you start looking at how much affordable housing is actually available for those households, it squeezes down awful quick. And then folks that we talk about in the housing world is the extremely low income, which are making 30% of the area median income or below, which again is somewhere in the range of 26,000. It varies by household size and different things, but about that range. Yeah, Jennifer.
And I just I pulled out my phone and I crunched the numbers. We, as a society, have defined $15 an hour as a living wage. That person earning $15 an hour could afford $780 a month. The problem with that is that the average rental cost in Eden Prairie is $1,400.
Yeah, right.
So they're making like half.
That's right.
Of what they need for housing to be affordable here. And one of my big concerns is that the rental housing that we have here is going to be flipped. It's the apartment you could get for $780 is older. People want to come in and buy it and demolish it and rent more expensive apartments.
And we're going to talk about that too. Yep.
I mean, for me, I feel like policymakers aren't working from numbers that are real.
Mm-hmm. I think that's right.
Yeah. Well, 40% of renters isn't even covering our cost burden, so that's a huge issue.
Yeah.
40, so she was saying 40% of renters in Eden Prairie?
Yep.
Cost burden. So it's a challenge, right? And there's not enough, so don't get hopeless. We get into action, right? So what is going to
this? So, one church.
That's right. So another thing I just wanted to talk briefly about then was the second area is about, you know, what is the cost to actually develop and operate housing? Why is housing so unaffordable, right? And we've talked a little about this, right? That the market is not producing enough housing across every income scale, right? And vacancy rates, does anyone know sort of what a healthy vacancy rate might be?
5%.
So 5% exactly is what sort of the economists and the market folks are looking for to say the housing is in balance, right? Mm-hmm. That there's enough income coming into a building that it's cost effective for an owner to actually run the building, but not so much that there's never any availability. That's not what we're experiencing, our vacancy rates, at all. And of course, what's happening is that when it costs so much to develop and operate housing, someone's paying for that, right? And what we're seeing now, when there's insufficient other strategies for local governments and counties and the state and federal, is that those costs just get put right on to the folks that can least afford it, right? So let's dig into this a little bit. It's a little complicated, but it's actually my favorite chart. So I just want to walk through this for a moment. Last year, the governor created a governor's housing task force and met for 7 months with across a multi-sector group of folks coming together saying, what do we need to do in Minnesota to begin to address this? And recommendations came out, 30 different recommendations came out of that, talking about what the state can do, what local governments can do, and counties can do, and what the private sector can do, and sort of all these different strategies. One of the data points in that conversation was, well, what are we producing now, right? So this is annual rental production of what's actually happening, and then it's put next to it is what we actually need. Right, so this is just every year, and this was, I think, used 2017. So what this is showing, and that gets back to the area median income, what we were talking about, that for folks at the very lowest income, the annual production is 100 units in the state of Minnesota, 100 units at 30% of income that are produced, new units produced. For folks that tend towards the higher end of the income levels, but still need some, you know, affordable housing, so 80% of area median income, let's say $65,000 and above, something in that range. What's happening is that actual production, 7,000 units of the, I don't know, 12,000 units or so, are being produced at this level each year. Now, and 100 for the very lowest income. If we were actually producing, we, meaning as a community, right? If we're actually producing the amount that was calibrated and balanced to what the need is, you know, each year, just for population growth and such, it would be almost a quarter, right? That would be divided almost evenly across these income levels. Mm-hmm. So there's this, but when you look here, that's 2,500 families that every year will need housing that's affordable. And they could be working full-time, hard-working families, right? Giving you your coffee, taking care of kids, and we're producing 100. So that says that the market is not going to solve this.
Right.
Right? The market is not solving for this. And even with this, if you saw again the headlines a couple days ago, that's still not enough housing for the growth that our state is experiencing, and for the employers that are trying to like grow and work. Yeah. Please, Joan.
Why is the market producing more housing there than even needed? Wouldn't that be wouldn't there be a glut on housing that in that range that they would be able to rent?
Eventually, as this plays out, yes. But what's happening is that these people are paying too much for their housing. Right?
Yeah.
That the options aren't there and people are paying too much because there's not good options available. The other thing, so I just want to do this next slide, and we can come back to the other one, my favorite one. So what I just showed you was the annual mismatch of what's being created. This is talking about just that the very low income segment, right? But there's about over 100,000 households in the Twin Cities that year after year of not addressing that $2,500 a year for that lowest income in my previous slide, year after year after year of not meeting that need has created over 100,000 households at the very lowest income level that don't have access. So of that, those households, there's only 34,000 units available. Think about it, for every 100 folks, there's 34, or every 100 households at the very lowest income level, there's only 34 available and affordable apartments. Ooh. So what we have is a gap that's built up over time of more than 68,000 units that we need, right, of affordable housing to address this. Now, you know, we could all just say, oh, let's just pack up and go home, right? But we can do this. We can do this. But we need to lean in, right? It needs to be an intentional strategy, and it needs to be different from what we're doing today, right? Does this make sense? Any questions on this? Yes,
are families bunching up together?
Absolutely.
Or okay, so maybe three families in one unit?
So I would say people are adapting in lots of different ways. So overcrowding is how we talk about this, that is absolutely something that is happening. Again, living in substandard housing that people are willing to access, to pay, just to access some kind of housing, where renters without a lot of income don't feel like they have the political power to actually demand and live in stable, safe housing. There's, you know, a lot of what we're seeing too, a year ago, 2 years ago, we saw this statistic that in the Twin Cities, and maybe you guys read this, did you see what percent of folks in poverty do you think are living in sort of the cities?